Morning. Welcome to First United Church this beautiful sunny February morning as we all gather together once more in God's church. When we come together, we do like to leave time for welcome and announcements, and so I'd like to open it up for moments. Are there any words of welcome or announcements to share this morning? Yes, Deborah. Come on up.
Good morning. Today is Scout Sunday. Some of you might know that I work for Scouts BSA, which is the new name for Boy Scouts of America. And we have a Cub Scout among us, Zach. Zach is a Lion Cub Scout. And in part of what it happens on Scout Sunday is the Scouts perform a service at church. Do you want to do the honors? So today Zach is going to be taking your announcements by bringing the microphone to you instead of doing what I did, which is come up here. Thank you, Zach.
So are there any words of welcome or announcements to be shared this morning? Zach will bring the microphone to you. There's one more.
My youngest son was born this day.
Oh, yay!
We haven't mentioned this very much since COVID, but we still do appreciate if you would continue to sign in on the attendance sheet at the back of the church. And we also have name tags for everyone. If you don't have a name tag and would like one, please indicate this on the attendance sheet. Thank you very much.
Well, I do have announcements. How did you know I had announcements to make? That's great, Zach. But before I do my announcements, are there any other announcements, words of welcome that we want to share? Well, then my announcements are that the sign-up sheet on the oak table for fellowship time is still in need of names as we go forward. So please, if you want to do fellowship and that's something that you have a heart for, or you maybe have never done it and you want to try it but you don't know how, sign up and write down that it would be new, and then we'll make sure to hook you up with a veteran and make sure that we have a good list going forward. plenty of opportunities coming up in March and April on the list, as you'll see when you go to sign up. My next announcement is that in your program, there's an insert, and on the insert has a list of our upcoming Lenten activities. This is another way that we're getting the information out to you, and so we will continue to email it out and snail mail it out for those that don't do email, and we'll continue to announce it as it comes up. But the first one coming up next is that next Sunday is our Shrove Pancake Breakfast Sunday. So after church next Sunday, we're going to all gather in the back and have pancakes and sausages and fruit and king cake, and we're going to celebrate the beginning of Lent in many respects, because then later that week, February 22nd, is our Ash Wednesday service. So next Sunday is our Shrove Tuesday Pancake Breakfast. We already have cooks lined up, but if you're interested in cleanup or setting up, let us know, and we can certainly use all the help that we can gather. And my last announcement that I have to make this morning in terms of what we have going on is that next Sunday, we are going to take up a special collection offering that will go out to help the victims of the earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. If you haven't been aware or following the news, entire cities have been destroyed. Cities the size of Little Falls have just been completely turned to rubble. Over 28,000, I think, is the latest number that have passed away in this extreme natural disaster. So next Sunday, we're going to take a special collection at the beginning of our service. We'll say some prayers around that, but certainly keep those families in our prayers as we pray for these tragic events throughout our world. And if you have any questions about that, you can certainly contact the office as well. Other words of welcome or announcements to share?
As everybody knows, our caretaker that we had hired last fall resigned. There's a posting going out, and we're taking applications for a new caretaker.
All right, any other, thank you, Dave, any other words of welcome or announcements to share? Did you have an announcement to make at all? All right, then, thanks for all your help, Zach. How about a round of applause for Zach helping us out? Great job. And now let us then take a breath and take this moment as we reflect and center ourselves and prepare for worship. The wonderful playing by Maxine reminds me to announce and thank Maxine for being here yet again with us, for Diana for singing for us, for Amanda and Prescott making it all run behind the scenes, and for the countless smiling faces and volunteers you saw on your way in and will see at fellowship today. Thank you for being the church together. Let us now rise as we are able in mind, body, and spirit and join in our call to worship together. Great is the wisdom of God, powerful and knowing. God gives us the choice to follow and to be faithful. Great is the wisdom of God, powerful and knowing. God offers others to warm us, food to fill us, and water to quench our thirst. Great indeed is the wisdom of the Holy One, powerful and knowing. God considers us with care and knows all our ways. Great is the wisdom of God. Let us worship and glorify our Creator. Praise be to our God, in whom we can trust and rejoice. And now let us join together in our prayer of invocation. Righteous God, in you we find life and liberty, compassion and care, redemption and reconciliation. You make your ways known to us, and you recognize your people as we are, fully human and made in your image. You come to us, and we come to you. Let us meet in this time and place
Let us bring our hopes, our fears, our joys, our sorrows, our successes, our disappointments, our everything, that we can trust you with the fullness of this gloriously complicated life, as you guide us, provide for us, and love us, yesterday, today, tomorrow, and throughout all of eternity. Amen. Our opening hymn today is What Gift Can We Bring? It's from the Methodist hymnal, the thick blue one, in or around your seat. Number 87, What Gift Can We Bring? Please be seated. Our prayer of confession today is inspired by the book of Sirach, chapter 15. Let us join now in his call and response as we pray in our prayer of confession. Was it God's doing that caused us to fall away? Was it by God's doing that we were led astray? No, it was my choice. It was the choice of those around me. It was the choice of my ancestors and generations before me. It has always been human choice that has taken the gift of free will and distorted it to fit our desires. It has always been the will of humanity to ignore or amend God's commandments to serve our wants. And in the process, our choices have led to death instead of life, prison instead of freedom, struggle instead of joy. God of our salvation, grant us anew your wisdom, your purpose, your light, your grace, that by your forgiveness we would live better, do better, love better, and faithfully be those whom you have chosen, those who have chosen you. Amen. Hear now these words of assurance. Some may want you to submit. Some may even want you to give up. Some may not even want you. But our God, who has given us everything we could ever need, asks us to choose. Let us then choose grace, mercy, and love. Let us be assured in our God. Amen. With hearts assured and at peace through confession and rejoicing having begun our worship, We now get to share God's peace with one another as we rise as we are able and share God's peace through hand or hug, maybe prayer for those who do not want to be touched, fist pounds, or for those online, certainly prayers of peace for all who are gathering near and afar. This is the sharing of God's peace. Such lovely conversations that we have during our moments of sharing God's peace, and certainly with those gathering with us again, either on Zoom or watching on YouTube later, we share our prayers of peace with you all. It's always fitting then, after we have received God's peace and shared it with one another, that we receive it also via God's word. Reading scriptures this morning for us is Amanda. Thank you, Amanda.
The first reading is from Deuteronomy 30, verses 15 through 20. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in God's ways, and observing God's commandments, decrees, and ordinances. Then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you do not hear but are led astray, to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall certainly perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying and holding fast to God, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that your Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The second reading is 1 Corinthians 3, verses 1 through 9. And so, brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still fleshy. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not fleshy and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not all too human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and each will receive wages according to their own labor. For we are God's co-workers, working together. You are God's field, God's building.
And we have a very special children's message today. Thank you, Deborah.
Hold that for me because I'm going to read something. All the kids come up. Come on up. Hi. Hi, you all. Okay, I'm going to face this way so I can read a story to you. Do you want to move in a little bit? Now, February is Black History Month. Have you been learning about that in school? A lot of stories and shows. I'm sure you all know the name Martin Luther King Jr. Well, I'm going to tell you something maybe you don't know about Martin Luther King Jr. Before becoming the leader of the civil rights movement in the 1960s and delivering the famous I Have a Dream speech, Martin Luther King Jr. was a Boy Scout. From ages 11 to 13, King was registered as a member of Troop 151 in Atlanta, Georgia. His troop met at Ebenezer Baptist Church, now part of the Martin Luther King Jr. National Historic Site. Now I'm going to tell you all about another famous African-American woman that you probably don't know about,
but you probably do.
Aletha Gibson. Before Venus and Serena Williams, there was Aletha Gibson, who dominated the tennis courts in the 1950s. At 15, she won her first American Tennis Association National Championship. She held that title for 9 years. Later, she became one of the first Black athletes to compete in international tennis. Gibson was the first Black player to win the French Open and Wimbledon, and she won the US Open in 1957 and 58. Gibson was also the first Black woman to compete on the Pro Golf Tour. One more. Guillaume Bluford. After serving in the Air Force for 13 years, Guillaume Bluford was named an astronaut. And in 1983, he became the first African-American in space. In all, he participated in 4 space shuttle flights from 1983 to 1992 and rose to the rank of colonel. Bluford is also an Eagle Scout. There's the pictures of some of the people we talked about. So I'm going to turn this way now. I want you to understand how the things that are important in your life guide you for your whole life, and how many people have shattered records and broken molds, and part of their life was scouting. Now, Aletha Gibson was not a Boy Scout. Do you know why? She was not a boy. But guess what? Now, if you're not a boy, you can still be a Cub Scout. Are there girls in your pack?
Yes.
So Zach is in a pack here in Little Falls. Mike Becker is the Cub Master. And the pack has kids ages 5, or kindergarten through 5th grade. What grade are you in? He started right on time. And then scouting, which used to be called Boy Scouts, and now it's just called scouting, is for boys and girls 6th grade through high school. So I wanted you to know that Black History Month is important, and the elements that you grow with are important too. Let's say a prayer. Can we hold hands? Dear God, bless these children and the lives they will lead. Let them be good representatives of how we grow this church, this community, and this world. Amen.
How about a round of applause for our children? Our next hymn is Where Charity and Love Prevail. It's in the Methodist hymnal number 549. We'll sing all verses, Where Charity and Love Prevail.
Exclude no race.
Our gospel reading today comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 12 and verses 21 through 29. Hear these words of Jesus at the end of his Sermon on the Mount. In everything, do to others as you would have them do to you, for this is the law and the prophets. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of God in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and cast out demons in your name, and do mighty works in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you who behave lawlessly. Everyone, then, who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew his house and beat against that house and it fell. And great was its fall. Now when Jesus had finished saying these words, the crowds were astounded at his teachings, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes. This is the word of our Lord. Let us pray. God, thank you for sharing your word with us as we gather in song, scripture, and prayer. Open our hearts, open our eyes, open our hands and feet, that all we may do, God, might bring you glory. Amen. On solid ground. You know, this gospel, this specific passage, when I was growing up in Winona, was always a difficult one to hear. Because just about every house, unless you built up on top of the hill in Winona, every house down in the valley, just about, there were some places, but they were all built on sand. It was a sandbar. I mean, you couldn't. Winona is known as the island city because it was developed between two. The river used to be in one spot, and then it moved, and a giant sandbar is where Winona is. And so every house in town in the valley, just about again, I'm sure there's some, but is built on sand. So much sand, in fact, that if you want to have any building above like 3 or 4 stories tall, you either build it wide so it can be tall, or you have to put pillars down like 100 feet into the sand. Now, I'm not a structural engineer, and that's not a precise number, but it's a ways down into the sand that you have to go before you actually reach bedrock, before you actually reach what's underneath the sand. So to hear this scripture passage about a house being built on sand, it was very cognizant to us also in Winona, because floods would come and wash things away. So we knew about how sand was temporary, how sand could be washed away, how the river in its course each year had to be dredged out for the towboats and the barges to go through because sand would fill back in, and it would come and it would go. This is what Jesus is trying to get at in this message that we've heard so many times about a house built on rock compared to a house built on sand. It's less about the material and it's more about the structure, right? We need to have a solid structure. We need to build on solid ground. But we hear this in this passage at the end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, when he's wrapping up this great preaching and teaching that he is doing. And he leads our chapter, our reading for today, with this line of the wrapping up the law and the prophecy and the commandment to do unto your neighbor as you would have them do unto you. That this is the solid ground upon which we need to build. And what's so wonderful about our last 3 weeks as we've been leading up to today, I guess including today, the last
2 weeks leading up to today. As we've been having this wonderful journey, as we've been going through and hearing from the prophets and them crying out to these people, that the people have been crying out to them saying, what am I supposed to do? What is it that you want us to do, God? How do you want us to sacrifice and live? And the prophets respond back by giving the voice of God saying, to do justice, to love and kindness, and to be humbly walking with your God. The prophets call out and say that God wants none of these secondary sacrifices, but that God wants us to be the hands and feet of God and to serve others and to be with others in their time of need. And then we get to today and we get this great Deuteronomical text that says we have a choice. We get to choose. See, the prophets weren't including that in their message, but it was underneath there, that we get to choose. And what the Deuteronomical text tells us is that we get to choose between life and death, that we get to choose between freedom and being trapped, that we get to choose whether we are going to follow God or follow our own gods. And this is what works into what Jesus is saying at the end of his teaching, how we need to treat our neighbor as ourselves, because then we get this very not so nice glimpse from Jesus about what the future will hold. Jesus says, I am going to be judge, and there will be some that come and say, Lord, Lord, and Jesus will say, I don't know you. Oof. That hurts, doesn't it? Everything we know about our Jesus is love and welcome and prosperity and being a place of comfort and a place that we can go when we need help, in a place where we can be called and be at the feet of Jesus. And yet we hear to some who say, but did I not prophesy in your name? Some who say, but did I not cast out demons in your name? Some who would say, but did I not live a great Christian life in your name, Jesus? And then Jesus would say to them, I don't know you, because you did not follow the law. The law is tough for us, but what Jesus is referencing here goes back to not just what Jesus has taught, but the Deuteronomical choice that he was telling us before Jesus existed, when God was God, and we had this Deuteronomical text that tells us that we get to choose between life and death, between living as God has called us or living in some other way, between following God's commandments and what God longs for in our life, or following our own path and adventure, for following Jesus into this place of hope and prosperity and love, or going after what the world thinks is hope, prosperity, what the world thinks it looks like to love. This is a tough message, because it then brings us back to say, well, how do we know? And it seems like we're right back at square one. How do we know what is the law? How do we know what are the commandments? How do we know what is the correct prophecy? How do we know what is the capital T truth that we're supposed to be following? How do we know what we're doing is right? And that's when Jesus tells us, the ones who have done what I have taught, the ones who follow what I have said, and the ones who go and act and share and do in our world are the ones that are written in the law. And it goes back to that first verse we read in the gospel passage today. In whatever you do, the fulfillment of the law and the prophecy. Remember, that's what Jesus said. This is all the law and the prophecy. is to do to your neighbor what you want done to you. Do to your neighbor what you want done to you. And I would add, it's not in our readings for today, but when Jesus tells us the great commandment to love one another as we have been loved, that is doing to your neighbor what you would want done to you. How do we place ourselves on solid ground? We do to our neighbor what we want done to us. Do we want to have everything we could possibly need on our shelves in our house, that if we need to make supper, we can go in and we can open the cabinet and we can know we've got everything there that is made to make supper? Then our neighbor needs that too. Do we want to be able to drive the nicest car that we can possibly afford? Then our neighbor needs that opportunity too. Do we want to not have people talk about us behind our backs, to not have people spit hate about us? Do we want people to respect us and lift us up? Do we want people to love us? Do we want to be loved? Then we need to offer all of those things to our neighbor as well. Do we want to be loved, as we heard about in our gospel or in our readings today, for how we were made as humanly made, no matter if it's just this flesh and bone, this sinful flesh and bone, no matter what, do we want to be loved by our God and known and recognized for who we are, for who God made us to be? Then we need to see that in our neighbor as well. Because if we only love ourselves, if we only keep to ourselves, if we only hold for ourselves and gather in and store for ourselves, and we don't share in the way that we would want to be shared with, then we are not following God's commandments. And we are not following God's law. And we are not building our house on solid ground. But we are building our house on the sands of the world that can be wiped away in an instant. Our God longs for us to build our house on God's property. God's property isn't rock or sand. It's not clay or whatever loam you can imagine. God's property is forever and eternal. It is built upon the law and the prophets. It is sustained by the love of Christ, and it is filled with the Holy Spirit. And that is where God longs for us to forever be, on that solid ground. But if we want to be on that solid ground, we've got to open our door to our neighbors. And our neighbors are not just here in this room. Our neighbors are not just in our neighborhood, as we would call it, in that house or this house or that house, but our neighbors encompass the world. So when we see someone struggling to have the life that we would want to have, God is calling us to step in. When we see others struggling to be respected in the way that we would want to have respect and dignity, God is calling us to step in. When we see others that are not being loved, but are being hated and talked down about and spoken against and separated and delineated and being made to be other, then God is calling us to build our house on the solid ground of trusting in the love of God that can go across borders, that can go across race, that can go across political divides, that can go across sexual orientation, that can go across denominations, that can go across religions, and can reach people where they are as human beings, as neighbors, as all those that God loved. And if you have any doubts about it, think of those words that Paul used at the end of this scripture passage to the church in Corinth. God is going to take care of any of the work that we do. We don't have to worry about knowing everything. We don't have to worry about having everything. We don't have to worry even about doing everything. But we need to plant, and we need to water sometimes, and God will make it grow. Because on God's land, there is no sand that can be washed away. There's not even rock that can be broken by earthquake. But there is solid ground upon which we can build that is the love of God. So friends, let us be the planters, the waterers, the ones that indeed treat others as we would long to be treated, and the ones that can not just be those who follow the law and the prophets, but those who proudly proclaim that we are offering everything in Christian love, that we are welcoming people to build with us, and that we are doing so with the love of God at our center on solid ground. Will you please pray with me? God, what a challenging message today that you have given. What a challenging scripture passage that you have given us today, God. Because it's so easy to point the finger, to blame others, to be sanctified by our self-satisfaction and our self-sanctification that we are saved because we know you, Christ. When in fact, what you call us to is a deeper understanding, a deeper knowledge that to be built on solid ground requires us to not just know you, but to help others to know you through our actions. To be built on solid ground, God reminds us to follow your commandments, and that you have given us a choice. This great gift of free will, this wonderful ability that we can go home today and we can do nothing and yet still be relatively okay. And yet we're not, God, okay. We're not okay if we go home and we hate our neighbor and we talk down about those who are different. We are not okay if we don't love those who we may not even like. Because you, God, are calling us to a deeper understanding that choosing you means love for all as you have loved all, God. Choosing you means following in these prophetic footsteps of doing justice, of loving kindness, of walking humbly with you, of sacrificing ourselves, God, not and so that we increase our own personal holiness, but so that we can increase the well-being of those around us, and that we would choose life in you, God. That we would be those who indeed offer others what we ourselves would want. That we, God, would hear what Christ is teaching us about love and peace and hope and joy, and that we could offer that to our world as those built on solid ground. That's a hard message, God. We need your help. We need your help to know what that looks like in our lives. What does that look like for us specifically here and in our life as we journey forth throughout this week? What does that look like, God, in our day-to-day interactions? What does that look like, God, where I work? What does that look like, God, where I rest? What does that look like, God, when I'm with friends, strangers, loved ones, or enemies? Because what you long for is it for all to look like love, God. So fill us with your Holy Spirit. Help us along our way, God, that we indeed could be welcomed home by your solid ground. But we lift these prayers up today, and I know we have prayers on our hearts, and so I want to lift up prayers of the community. And our Cub Scout helper is going to help us during prayers of community too. So Zachary is going to bring around the microphone if anyone has a prayer to lift up during this time.
I ask for prayers for the Damon family with the tragic loss of a father and a son. They're a distant relative of my husband's.
Lord, have mercy. Other prayers of our community. I have a prayer. Hold on, stay with you. I again want to lift up those in Turkey and Syria, and all of the family and friends of those who have lost loved ones, who don't know it yet if they've lost loved ones or are still trying to figure out what life looks like moving forward after these terrible natural disasters. Other prayers of our community.
Continued prayers for our friend Charlie Larson, who is awaiting his cancer prognosis, and our friend Steve Payan, who is dealing with cancer.
Lord, have mercy.
Other prayers of the community.
One big prayer of thanks for Zachary and all of our children, and for all of those in scouting. I like that they've changed the title to be inclusive. All of those in scouting as they learn just what kind of moral and ethical living looks like in our world. Thanks for your help, Zachary. Let us take a moment now and silently pray and join all of our prayers in that silence and lift them up to God. Let us join all of our prayers this morning together as we pray our prayer of our Savior together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. It's now time for offerings, so I'm going to let the children go off to Sunday school. And I think we have Mary Lou doing it today, and she's already there, I think. So hopefully you remember where the Sunday school room is. If not, some of the older students can help you. And for the rest of us who remain, it's now time for our holy offering. We're going to hear some music here in just a little bit. The song we're going to hear is called The Offering, and it's by Michael W. Smith. As you listen to this beautiful music, as you spend time in reflection, think about indeed what God is calling us to. What is a world offering in our world? What does it look like to live with our neighbor and our loved ones being treated the way we would want to be treated, our enemies, our strangers being treated the way we would want to be treated? What would that offering be to our world as we now listen during Holy Offering? And now let us rise in mind, body, or spirit and join in our doxology together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Hallelujah.
Let us now join in our prayer of dedication together. Generous God, take our offering we bring today and use these wages of our labors to ease the burden of others, that our choice to give might allow for others to know your love. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 480, O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go. This has a lot of old English in it, wilt and eths and all of that, thous and these. I left them in and I love them in here purposefully, because what it allows us to do is sit in this place of trusting where God is leading, in these words that slow us down and these language that has been gone for a long time but is still here. So this is O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go, all verses, number 480. Included this last hymn for us today because it's important to know and understand that God's love never lets us go. No matter what we do, no matter how far we go, no matter what it is in life that we may stumble upon, God's love is there with us always. But that light and that peace and that hope and joy is what Christ calls for us to share with our world. And so let us go trusting in our God, trusting in a love that won't let us go, and share that with those who long to know, long to hear, long to be loved, that this love would not be forgotten, forsaken, or put aside, but would grow and prosper, and this world could know God's love. Amen.